figure out a way to grow 3 years' worth of food here on a planet where nothing grows. Luckily, I'm a botanist.
Matt Damon stars in The Martian. He plays an astronaut stranded on Mars after his crew is hit by a sandstorm. The movie is number one at the box office. Weekend ticket sales reached at least $55 million. But is the drama realistic about science? Neil deGrasse Tyson is an astrophysicist. He is director of the Hayden Planetarium at the American Museum of Natural History here in New York. Welcome back to Studio 57.
Thanks. Yeah.
So this movie gets the science right.
Yeah, it gets enough of the science right so that where it doesn't get it right, you give them some space to do that so they can help tell their own story.
And what is that science they got right?
Oh, so there are a couple of things that you might not have even noticed. For example, because it was subtle, but it meant they were really thinking deep. There are occasions where Matt Damon, the lead character, he drops things to the ground. It actually falls to the ground more slowly because gravity on Mars is only 40% that of Earth. They could have just ignored that, and I might have even given it to them because they're filming in some studio somewhere. How are they going to turn on a switch and have the studio have 40% gravity? That would be really hard, if not impossible. I would have given that to them if they couldn't. But in fact, they figured out how to film that. A couple of other things, for example, Matt Damon is lifting these heavy, heavy tanks. Now, he's physically fit in the movie, and they make sure you know that with a couple of, there's always the ab shot, you know.
Don't knock the ab shot.
No, I get, you got to put in the ab shot. Well, I'm okay with that. But he's lifting these heavy things, and you might think that it's because he's physically fit. But if it's a 200-pound tank, it weighs 80 pounds on Mars. And so they put thought into it. So I applaud that effort, yes. And there's a place, but now the sandstorm, there's a dust storm that kicks up and it terrorizes their spaceship. But the Martian atmosphere is less than 1% the thickness of our atmosphere. And so when the wind kicks up, it doesn't pick up heavy things. It can't. Mm-hmm. And so it picks up only very light dust. That's why they're called dust storms. So they exaggerated the impact of a dust storm on Mars. But I give that to him because we know Mars has dust storms and even these little dust devils that kick up, mini tornadoes that were showed persistently throughout the film. So I'm a fan of Mark Twain's edict where first get your facts straight,
right,
then distort them at your leisure.
What's fascinating is these movies used to come out and no one pretended they were you. Now everyone pretends they're you and says, well, this detail was wrong. Well, this detail was wrong. What struck you, though, aside from that sandstorm, is something they really got wrong?
No, what they got wrong, they did their homework on other things to get right, to have earned. So I don't think of it as wrong. I think of it as, let's be a little loosey-goosey here so that this story could be told a little in a more fun way or a more intriguing way. So, for example, they have the Jet Propulsion Labs at Pasadena, California, in control over the mission, sharing control over a manned mission along with Houston. No, that doesn't happen. They're purely, purely space probes at JPL. But it enabled two NASA centers to have this conversation where you have these sort of, it's a geek culture. You got the mathematician and the orbital mechanics and the engineer all trying to solve problems. And one of my favorite aspects of the film was that science is its own character, in a sense, in this film, because of the drama, the suspense, the emotions, the pride, envy, all the normal characteristics we think of human dynamics, all happen through the lens of science.
Last week, NASA announced that there was flowing water on Mars. Same time this movie's coming out, the significance of that?
Yeah, so we've always known that at some time there was water on the surface. There are these dried, meandering riverbeds, mm-hmm. but completely dry river deltas, floodplains. And so the question has always been, where is the water today? Right. Is it underground? And if it is it frozen? But if it's any place liquid, that's kind of useful to know. Because NASA has an entire branch of itself concerned with what they call ISRU, in-situ resource utilization. If you know there's water on your destination planet, you don't have to bring any with you. Mm-hmm. And that greatly improves your or reduces the launch costs.
And does it increase the likelihood there's some kind of life there?
Yeah, that is clearly the next question that everyone is asking. One of NASA's mantra is follow the water, because what's driving us is the search for life, of course, be it microbial or otherwise. And if you've got liquid water oozing out the side of a crater wall on Mars, you want to sort of go digging in there and see if there are microbes
or
something.
And if they say
else.
Life, what does that mean?
Well, life. Well, we only one of the great secrets that biologists don't share with you behind closed doors is that in spite of the diversity of life in the world, we all have DNA in common. So in fact, we are a sample of one. And can you really understand your subject if you're dealing with a sample of one? That's why the beginning of every biology book, what is life? Is it this? Does it require sunlight or just energy? Does it require liquid water or just a liquid? And so you can't answer those kinds of deep questions until you have another example of life. So if we found life on Mars, it would completely transform biology. And even as an astrophysicist, I consider the search for life in the universe to be one of the greatest and highest goals in all branches of science.
Got that.
So cool. Yeah. Thank you for spending your birthday with us.
Yes, happy birthday.
But my assistant had cleared the whole day, and then you guys had to call and
well,
ask
thank you
about
for letting
Mars.
Us interrupt
what a way
that.
To start the day.
What a way to start the day.
That's right.
Neil deGrasse Tyson, thank you so much.
Thank you.